Hi everyone, I'm Nelson Senjan, a PhD student with SHREC at the University of Florida. And I'm here to share with you our efforts towards having a suite of middleware services for enhanced spacecraft configuration and capability. So I'll start by going through some of the key technologies that we'll be employing. Then I'll go over the motivations and goals for this project. After that, I'll go over the architecture that we've chosen to use for the space middleware, followed by a brief description of our prototype, and finally with the conclusions. So space middleware is a research project at SHREC, which is an NSF center for high performance and reconfigurable computing. It consists of three university sites and over 30 industry and government partners. And the University of Florida is the lead site for SHREC. And the space middleware investigation is a collaborative SHREC effort. And we have some of the key partners include NASA, Kennedy, the NASA GONAD, JSC, LRC, and ARC. We also have Honeywell and Lockheed Martin Space Vehicle Integration Lab. So let's have a look at some of the key technologies that we are using. So the first one is CoFlight Executive, and we are trying to integrate some other technologies on top of CFE in order to have the goals that we are targeting. So the other technology is DDS, which is a specification by the Object Management Group. And this specification aims at having a dependable real-time and high performance data network. So it uses a publish subscribe model for exchanging data, events, and commands. And it greatly simplifies complex network programming and makes it easy to develop data-oriented applications. So there exist multiple DDS vendors such as OpenDDS, which is developed by ONG. Then you have OpenSplice and Cortex DDS, just to name a few. So some of the main DDS entities include a domain. So a domain is a conceptual container, and for any publisher or subscribers to communicate, they have to belong to the same domain. Then we have a topic, which is a data object that is exchanged between the subscribers and publishers within a given domain. So publishers are basically data producers, and they're the ones that are responsible for creating topics within a given domain, and they publish data samples to that topic for the subscribers to receive them. And then subscribers are basically the data consumers in the network. And every sample that's published by the publishers is received by the subscribers. So, and for, since DDS is a specification, and there are very many vendors who have implementations for it, it's important to have a way for the different vendors to interoperate. And this led to the development of the DDSI RTPS specification, which basically it's an interoperability protocol that allows these different vendors to be able to communicate with each other. So the next technology we are using is ADAM, and this is an ongoing project at the SHREC. And its main aim is to provide a platform for dependable science data processing in a distributed space computers. So it does this by providing an API for application developers to use to design fault tolerant applications targeted at for space work. So it basically consists of a network of agents, and each agent assumes roles of either a coordinator or a worker. So some of the main parts of ADAM include, so we have the peer discovery, which basically helps each node in the network to discover each other. Then you have the health reactor, which tracks changes in peer availability. So whenever a new node joins the network, or whenever a node disconnects from the network, it's possible for all the other nodes to be aware that a given node has disconnected or has a new node has joined the network. Then you have the task manager, which is used by the coordinator of the network to issue tasks to other nodes in the same network. And then you have a coordination manager, which is involved in coordinator elections in the network. So all the nodes in the network communicate by use of heartbeats, which is basically a beacon that's sent periodically to all other nodes in the network, informing them of system events such as a newly joined agent, a disconnected agent, or a reconnected agent. So here's a brief architecture of ADAM. So it uses the CZMQ framework for the public subscribe network. So the main features of ADAM. ADAM provides task redundancy, both spatial and time-based. So in spatial task redundancy, you basically you can have the same task to be executed across different nodes, and then you have the coordinator to compare the results of all the nodes. Or in case of time-based redundancy, we can have things like timed TMR, where you have a single node to execute the same application three times or n times, and then compare the results. And then in case one of the nodes in the network, for example, a worker node fails, it's possible for the coordinator to reassign the work for that node onto another node. And then in case a coordinator fails, the remaining nodes in the network are able to elect a new coordinator and continue on with the data processing that they are doing. And in order to achieve coordinator failure, we are currently using the Raft consensus algorithm, which was developed by Stanford University. And then you also have a per device or per node process failover. So in this case, if any of the ADAM processes fails, we have an external daemon that monitors the execution of the ADAM processes, and it's able to respond any of the ADAM processes in case they fail. And then the next technology now is a processing board, which is called the Shrek Space Processor. And its main goal is to have a low power, high performance, and high reliability / availability computing platform. So it consists of components, both quartz and Red Hat, and they can easily be swapped. So for example, depending on the cost requirements that you have, it's possible to replace a Red Hat component in the board with a quartz component and vice versa. So, and for the CSP, its first mission will be next year, and it will be going to the ISS. So the next technology that we are using, which is again a hardware, it's the modular integrated stackable layers, or MISL for short. It was developed at NASA JSC. And its main goal is to provide a modular stack of hardware boards. So it basically has a series of hardware boards that are stacked together. And it's very easy to change them. For example, if you have the processor currently is MSP430, and you need some additional power, it's easily swappable with another board, which has a higher performing microcontroller. So this one, it makes it easy for quick prototyping of applications. And it's targeted at LEO environments. So here are some of the related work that we looked through when you are coming out with our proposed architecture. So moving on to the motivations and goals for our approach towards having a space middleware platform. So in coming up with our architecture, we had to look at the needs for a flight software platform. So this means the current needs and the future needs. So for example, a space middleware platform could have needs such as fast prototyping, plug and play capabilities, etc. So the current tool sets, for example, CFS, it provides fast prototyping, code reuse between multiple missions, and on top of that, we needed to have additional features, such as enhanced configuration by being able to plug, for example, smart modules, and have them being automatically configured. So this made us come with the notion of a flight system management. So a flight system management, it focuses on the system-wide resource use and management. So this scenario will include, for example, you have multiple space processors and they communicate in order to perform distributed computing. So this is an example of a smart module that can be found on a small set. So here we are. I have an outline of our areas of work and interest. So for example, starting from a flight computer management platform, for example, with the CFS, we want to add enhanced capability and enhanced configuration. So for the enhanced configuration part, we need to add some plug and play capabilities. And this is provided by DDS. And then on the enhanced capability side, we need to have a dependable, distributed, and parallel space platform. So this enhanced capability, it will help us to perform science data processing in space. So a mix of all three of this will lead us to having a flight system management, which will be able to manage all the system-wide resources in space. So here's an example of comparison. So in a centralized architecture, which consists of a space computer and some attached units. So these units may be some sensors. So in this case, CFS works best and we don't need anything else. But if you move on to a distributed architecture, on top we need to have some additional functionalities on top of CFS in order to perform distributed processing in space. So this diagram shows just some of the things that you might need to, or some of the services you might need to put on top of CFS in order to have distributed processing space. So for example, you may need to have a distributed task layer, and in our case, this will be provided by ADA. So the first goal of having an enhanced spacecraft configuration. So this one will help to expedite spacecraft development by facilitating quick prototyping, integration by use of plug and play, and easy testing. And this will also enable in-flight configuration. And the technologies that we'll be employing for this case will be CFE, and also DDS, and specifically the RTPS layer of DDS, which provides automatic device discovery. So on the enhanced capability side. So on the enhanced spacecraft capability side, our main goal is to have parallel computing in space. So here we envision a system of where we have distributed resources in space, and by resources we mean space computers and smart modules. So smart modules may include smart instruments or smart sensors that they basically get data from the environment and send over the data to the space computers for processing. And finally, the space computers will send the data back to the ground station. So in this case, instead of sending the data directly to this to the ground station for processing, we do the processing on in space, and we just downlink the results. And then here's an architectural overview of our approach. So here we have a couple of space computers and smart modules connected across a network. So since for the smart modules, they have different capabilities. So depending on the capability that the smart modules have, we can either run a full stack DDS, or if it is very low, it's low performing, we can just run a subset of DDS that we really need. So for example here, we can just write an application on top of the RTPS protocol, or if it's high performing, we can use the full stack DDS and write the application on top of it. And on the space computer side, we have the CFE, and for CFE to interact with ADAM, we created an ADAM CFE bridge. And for in order to get data from DDS, we created a DDS CFE bridge and an ADAM DDS bridge. So in this case, all the developer has to do, he just has to create and to interact with ADAM by creating an ADAM application. And this ADAM application will interact with ADAM via an API that we provide. So next, I'll talk briefly about the prototype that we're developing that will be using our architecture. So the prototype will emulate a distributed measurement pathfinder, or DMP in short. So this will consist of three small satellites flying in formation. Each of them will have a camera and two space processors. So the camera will be built on top of the missile stack. And for simplicity, we assume that the network is unified. So we just have one network. And all these devices will be connected via a network bridge, which will basically be an Ethernet switch. And some of the hardware components we'll be using 6 CSP version 1 computers, 3 missile boards with the RM48 microcontroller, and 3 sensors, 1 imaging sensor, a thermocouple, and an accelerometer. So all this will be connected over an Ethernet switch, and finally we'll have a ground station. So this testbed configuration. So we'll have the computers and the smart modules, which will be the missile stacks, and then we'll have a ground station which will be running Cosmos. And then these are some of the planned prototype, the use cases that we plan to showcase our architecture. So we'll have a use case for verifying the communication between the CSPs and the smart modules, for verifying the plug and play functionality, the distributed processing by use of an image stereoscopy application, and then parallel processing. And then you have a use case also for verifying the coordinator failover and the process failover capabilities of our architecture. And then here's a progress of the project, a progress of the prototype. So for the prototype, we've chosen OpenDDS, which will be the DDS implementation that will be running on the smart computers. And then since the RM48, it's not powerful enough in terms of RAM to support a full stack DDS implementation. So we just chose to use a subset of the DDS specification, which is FreeRTPS. And for that we chose the FreeRTPS implementation, which is provided by Open Source Robotics Foundation. And then we define some message types in IDL format. So this will be the messages that will be exchanged between the smart computer and the modules. And then on the CFE side, we also build a CFE DDS bridge. And we also build an ADAM DDS bridge. So for the CFE DDS bridge, what it will basically be doing is forwarding of commands from the ground station over to the smart modules. And to do this, we have a CFE app that will be receiving commands from the ground station, and then it will forward all the commands to a Unix socket. And then we'll have a DDS app that will be listening on the same Unix socket. And whenever the commands arrive, it will convert them in DDS form and forward them to the relevant modules. And then we also have the ADAM DDS bridge. And this is responsible for forwarding DDS data from smart modules over to the to applications that run on ADAM. So these applications that run on ADAM, they'll be the one that will be receiving sensor data, processing them, and sending them over to the ground station. So, and to do this, all what an ADAM application developer has to do is he just has to define a topic name. So this is the DDS topic name of the data he wishes to receive, or the data he'll be utilizing for his application. And then he also needs to define a callback function. So this is a function that will be called every time the data samples on the topic is specified are available for him. And then a brief overview of the upcoming developments. So since currently FreeRTPS doesn't support RM48, we've been developing a port of FreeRTPS for the RM48. And then on the ADAM side, we are about to finish the implementation of coordinator failover and per device process failover capabilities. And then we are also adding an MPI-like functionality on top of ADAM. So we'll be having functions like ADAM send, ADAM receive, and ADAM barrier, which will mimic the behavior of the corresponding MPI functions like MPI send, MPI receive, or MPI barrier. And then finally, we'll be adding capability for the ADAM framework. We'll be adding a logging framework on top of ADAM, which will have log replication capability across all the nodes. And then in conclusion, so this Shrek Space Middleware, it's an ongoing project, and currently our focus is mainly on two goals. So the first one is enhanced spacecraft configuration. The second one is enhanced spacecraft capabilities. And our initial prototype will be showcased in the beginning of December at the Shrek annual workshop, which will be held at the Kennedy Space Center. So I now welcome any questions that you might have.
Hello. Yeah, there's a lot of work there.
Yeah.
I don't. Does ADAM have a recovery reconfiguration capability, or is it just failover?
What do you mean by recovery?
Well, meaning once there's a node that's failed, is there a way to recover that failed node?
Yeah. So for recovery, it depends on the type of recovery. Currently, just support. For example, if maybe the operating system for some reason has killed an ADAM process, we are able to detect that and restart the process.
So it, like, does that mean a restart or a reset of the module?
No, we don't reset the entire module. We just restart the ADAM process.
So there's a recovery mechanism or resynchronization?
Yes.
What RTOS does this sit on?
No, currently we are just using Linux for the start, and maybe we'll move it over to other operating systems.
Real-time Linux?
No.
I'm sorry, I didn't.
No, we're just using Linux.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Just plain.
Yeah, plain Linux.
Okay.
So I was curious why the on the connection to CFS, CFS, why you needed a Unix socket to talk to the DDS. What's the utility there? I thought for DDS you could just do the callback inside your application. Is there something there?
We needed to decouple in order to have the bridge. We have two tasks. The first task is getting the commands from the ground station, and the second task is sending the commands to the smart modules. So instead of having an app running on top of CFE that, like, instead of having a DDS app directly on top of CFE, we thought it was wise to separate, to decouple the two by having a CFE app that's only concerned with getting data from the ground station, and then a DDS app that's just concerned with sending data. So okay. I thought it was wise to communicate via a socket.
And you had to have a whole separate inter-process communication for that?
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Anybody else? Okay. Thank you, Nelson. Thank you very much.